The way software is developed, delivered, and maintained has changed. It's continuous and constantly moving forward. It demands measured progress. Are you passionate about DevOps? You know, it's not about the destination, it's about the journey. So let's go after it. Are you DevOps driven? Then let's go. Hey, I know you. Welcome to another episode of DevOps Driving. I'm Scott Moore, your host. Thanks for joining me. Today's show is a little bit different. We typically talk about the software development lifecycle and DevOps for the end user experience, right? We develop software, users use it. But what if you're building software and your end users are the developers that build software for other companies? For example, testing companies make testing software for companies to test their software that they're building for their ultimate end user. Isn't that something about the movie Inception? I'm not sure. But that takes me to Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania to talk to my old friend, Cyrus Manacharian. So Cyrus has a unique perspective on the development of software that's used by companies that are in various levels of maturity in their DevOps journey. So I wanted to talk to him about the very topic of how do you build software with other companies in mind that are going to use it to build their software. How does that even work? Let's talk to Cyrus. So I'm here today with my longtime friend, Cyrus.
Good to see you, Scott.
Cyrus, why don't you introduce yourself to our audience to tell them who you are and what you do?
Absolutely. So my name is Cyrus Manacharian. I'm a director of corporate development over here at tricentis. And we'll get to talk to a lot of interesting folks around acquisitions, partnering, and yeah, that's kind of what we do.
What I want to talk to you about is you have a very interesting history in that you have played many roles, but the biggest one was the product manager role over a product that does performance testing. So you're building a tool internally at a company, and you're building software, but you're building it for people who are building software and who are delivering software. So tell me a little bit about what it's like to be in that position and what you have to do to make a product like that.
It's an interesting process. It's a fun and difficult position to be in. When you're starting to think about different capabilities, different features that will bring value to your customers, your mind starts racing. People internally have different ideas as well, but most importantly, the consumers of your product or products, they're the ones who drive a lot of the short-term roadmap, so to say. And it's a delicate balance act of pleasing your end users as well as what folks internally want to see the product, how the product evolves, and then also a little bit of your own touch as well. It was a very, very satisfying experience. If somebody asked me to go back to product, I probably would consider going back to it. Everywhere product management's done a little bit differently. So where I did do product management, it was very, very customer oriented. So a lot more on calls with customers, hearing problems that they may have with the product, what's working for the product, and also pitching your vision. And I found that to be probably the most rewarding experience, to actually see if your end users are, they like what they see, or even better, they agree with like where you're trying to take your product or products forward.
I would think that you have to have a lot of regular customer feedback, some way to meet with these people, or gather this feedback. Sometimes you have to go where they're at and get that. But you're gathering all this. At the same time, you have to think, where is the puck going to be in
right.
2 years from now?
Right.
How do you balance that with, we got to have this right now, with we also have to be the leader and be ahead two steps?
It's never just the product manager, right? So there's a whole team that's comes to make this product or products, depending on how what they're managing. So you still have folks in, obviously, in sales, customer success, solution architecture, product marketing are huge advocates. Also, and they have a lot of interaction with customers, especially at like conferences, trade shows, customer advisory boards. I mean, those are huge, and that's kind of like, you know, it's a culmination of everybody helping out. Sometimes it comes in just rapid fire emails or, you know, those 11 p.m. phone calls. These things are not working. We gotta figure it out. We're gonna need a patch or a hot fix or something. But all of these kind of like come together to kind of helps understand how your customers are using the product and then what feedback they have, positive or negative, to help you take your product forward.
Okay, so how do you decide who wins on the priority of what goes into the tool while still trying to maintain your competitive edge?
I think everywhere is different. What I had a chance to do was to create different buckets for any release that's coming up. And we tried to create a bucket that's really targeted towards customer feedback. We had a portal that customers could submit, not feedback, but like features, new features to come out with or enhance existing ones. So some of them, they used to just get really a high number of votes. So that indicated to us that that was something that we should kind of like pursue. We had like a customer bucket. There's always going to be like improvements and enhancements to the platform. You could call it technical debt, but there's always that the development team or teams, they got to do some of their stuff as well. It can't just be net new feature every single time. And then we always had a small bucket for like real-time issues that came in. So if like we're in the middle of a release, and something came in from a customer and they needed in the upcoming release, we tried to use that small bucket, depending on the size of it. So that's kind of how we did it. It worked up to an extent. I do think that the customer portal where they could submit like ideas or feedback and have the ability to have other customers vote for it was like that was a big breakthrough, because it gets tough when you just get email after email from a customer or somebody advocating for the customer, partners, it becomes quite cumbersome to manage.
So it kind of helps you build that backlog in a better way.
Think of it as like a public backlog that you don't commit to, but what you're trying to do is you're trying to gauge the community. How interested are you? Now, mind you, most of the time it was customers submitting feedback, but once in a while, I would just drop a feature and just see if anyone thought it was interesting, and that kind of gives you a good idea or a good indication of what to work on next.
Okay. Let's talk about DevOps now, okay. Because you have to build software now the way your customers are building software. They're trying to build software in a continuous fashion. Everything needs to be continuous these days. The testing needs to be continuous. The release needs to be continuous. So you had to move your model of building this software for them the same way. How easy of a transition is that?
It all comes down to your community. There are advanced practitioners who they are moving fast and they expect the software to move fast with them. And so you want to move with them. You have other people in the community that are used to doing it a certain way and it works and they use your product to the fullest and you also make them happy. I find that the ones that are very advanced or they're moving in a kind of like a DevOps motion where everything from development to testing to deployment is all done in a continuous fashion. They have a lot of feedback in regards to how your software can move with them. So I think it just comes down to interacting with those folks in the community, those customers that are moving fast, so you can understand, okay, I get what you're saying, let me take it back to the team and see if we can actually meet that criteria or even exceed it.
All right, so you're currently now in a different position. You're not a product manager anymore. So you're in tricentis, and you're having to be more strategic in how you think of how do we take tricentis and get them to the next level? How do we keep them 2 to 5 years ahead of our competition, but also meet our customers' needs as well? So I'm thinking it's a similar mindset as you had with product manager, but has it changed any, or and how do you keep that? How do you keep that mindset current? Like, how do you keep up with all this because it's changing so rapidly? How do you stay ahead?
Ultimately, the way we look at things is much more at a much broader level, and a lot more people are involved outside of just us in corporate development. So our product and technical leaders, sales, customer success, a lot of them provide input and feedback of where they would like to see the company go, especially in that 2 to 5 year range. And also, we in corporate development, we have to kind of be in tune with how the product teams are moving as well, because they almost ultimately set the tone and the stage for not just the next N release, but it's like N+2, N+3, N+4, right? Mm. So it gives us an opportunity when we understand what their vision and what their strategy is to go look and see if, is it too early? Is it the right time to acquire in a space that ultimately the product team is trying to get, but maybe they don't want to build, but they want to acquire to complete that vision or one of the visions that they have for a particular product or for tricentis overall.
So if it's just a quick, hey, we can fill this hole that we have much quicker and get to market faster with that, I mean, that's a no-brainer, right?
Sometimes it's a no-brainer. Obviously, you have to do like your due diligence and make sure that everyone is ultimately on board. Gap fillers are certainly one way to go. Others are kind of, you know, do you want to set a new trend? Which is kind of, you know, some acquisitions, not just by tricentis, but by others, they've been starting to do that as well. So it's kind of just like product management. It's a fine balancing act. I find that though with the corporate development side of things, a lot more people are there to share their vision and strategy, not in a combative way, but in a much more complementary way. So it helps you think. And so I think once you get everyone together, that helps to create the long-term strategy of not just growing tricentis, but how do we grow it and where do those acquisitions come from?
Sometimes you're going along just fine and you think you know where your vision's supposed to be, and then you have this disruptive thing that happens, AI, that just, you know, ChatGPT comes along and says, I'm the new, you know, star, and people just have to start making modifications to that. So where else do we see something other than AI that could be that big of a game changer? Is there something out there right now that I'm not aware of?
I mean, if I go back to my performance testing days, one of the biggest advocates I always had, whether it was consulting, solution architecture, product, it was the ability to bring observability data and a performance test run together. Mm-hmm. I'm waiting for somebody to come out with capability where the production data feeds and creates performance testing scripts. It's not by any means like the easiest thing to conquer, but I can imagine that we're getting awfully close to where AI or these LLMs are going to get us to a point where we can actually see something like that in the context of performance testing. There are people right now that are devoting their time to it, right? Mm-hmm. And they haven't come out of stealth mode, right, so to say, right? Right. So I think that 2 to 3 year timeline, we're going to start to see these companies coming out of stealth with this type of capability, using the performance one as an example, but in general, how AI and LLM can fit into the context of quality.
I'll tell you one that I would love to share with you, something that's been on my mind for a while, and I'll use a hospital as an example, a healthcare center who relies on electronic medical records, EMR applications, and they test the software just like everybody else does, but they're testing for things like, okay, I wanna test how long it takes for this screen to come up. I wanna test how long it takes for the database to retrieve the information and give it back. But ultimately what they're doing at this hospital is figuring out how long does it take for me to triage a patient to get them help that they need, and how can I reduce that amount of time? Because now you're talking about how much time can I save to prevent somebody from losing their life or quality of life? How can I increase that chance that they're gonna get help faster, which is gonna maybe save their life? Okay, that's the kind of stuff you can't put a dollar figure on. But if we could get technology to do that, to say, I'm not only performance testing the efficiency of the application, but the business process behind that application that you're trying to do, when you're doing this work. And you could use other things other than healthcare as well, but I think that's the golden chalice that people want to drink from, right? Would you agree with that? I mean, yeah. It's about bringing the business context to it.
You know, performance is like in the context, a lot more people think about it in the context of scalability and reliability. And that's like, you and James Pulley, every Black Friday, I'm looking for the tweets and the LinkedIn posts of who's going out and who has an outage.
It's coming.
It's coming. So like scalability and reliability are always like, they're always the hot topic. It's hopefully we will see that change in any industry, whether it's healthcare, pharmacy, any hospitality, anything, where now they're also trying to test for the performance of their end customer. So it's not just the typical, let me log in, let me buy something and let me check out, but they actually test to see at scale how this all works and how do I make this faster for the people that are using our product. I think people are doing pretty good job of it today. I think it's only going to get better, especially once AI and LLM are properly applied to software products.
Completely agree. Thanks so much for being on the show today. Appreciate it, Cyrus.
My pleasure, Scott.
Great conversation with Cyrus today. You know, the software that end users are using, they don't necessarily know or care how complex that software is to develop or test. So making a product that makes it easier for companies to test that product they're making, or just make it simpler for the end user to use, is always going to be a struggle. And the easier companies can make it, the better off they're going to be. Until next time, this is Scott Moore. Thank you for watching DevOps Driving. We'll see you on the next episode.